Welcome to Navigate STL Schools, a podcast. My name is Anastasia, and I am here with John Saunders of the Wesley House Association. How are you doing today, John?
Doing very well, Anastasia. How are you?
I am doing great. Good, so we start good. Off everybody with the same exact question. Mm-hmm. Tell me about your personal K-12 story. So coming up through K-12.
It's kind of interesting because I actually went to Catholic elementary school, public high school. However, those years in Catholic school were difficult because I wasn't the model student all the time. But one thing I will say is that the basic foundational education that I received in that Catholic elementary school put me in a very good position when I got to public high school, because I would say my freshman year, I may have been reading at an 11th grade level. Some of my classmates were reading at 4th, 5th grade level. Mm-hmm. And that opened my eyes to the fact that, Catholic or private school education provides a very strong foundation. However, that can be replicated across any lines as far as people being able to pay attention to what's important, and that's exposing kids to the educational resources available to them, what education can do for them, and how it impacts their life. So I learned at an early age that education is a very strong foundation for the rest of your life.
Great. So talk to me about the Wesley House. What is the Wesley House Association?
Wesley House Association was established in 1903 as one of eight settlement houses in St. Louis. And what a settlement house was is when immigrants came to St. Louis, whether it be from European countries or whatever the case may be, they sought out these settlement houses to get set up and get started with their life in this city. So Wesley House was originally one of those eight. It evolved over the years to become more of a community-based center. Actually, the location where we are at 4507 Lee, that building has been there since 1955. And I can really kind of attest to that because I actually attended Wesley House when I was a kid in the late 60s and early 70s, where that community where we're located was a very model middle-class African-American community. So Wesley House has been a staple in St. Louis since 1903, but in the heart of North St. Louis since 1955.
All right, so what is special about that North St. Louis community that you guys are in? What happens in that area, and why is it important that you're situated there?
Well, I mean, what's special about it is a mixed bag. It's special in a way that, and this is not on the positive side, it's a very high crime rate, violent crime, burglaries, assaults, you name it. It takes place in the 63115 zip code. However, because of that issue and those issues of being an underserved community, it has brought new awareness to the issues. And I know, you know, we may discuss COVID and its impact, but COVID has brought an awareness and a visibility to the community where we serve that had not been there before. So that has allowed us to create new relationships, new partnerships, such as the one that we're discussing today. Because it does take a village to raise our children. The village has changed somewhat, but as old saying goes, the game doesn't change. The players may, but the game doesn't change. So it's a very basic understanding that we have to provide services for kids, families, and older adults that live in that community. And that's how we adapt and keep going every day.
So what inspires you about the work that you guys do?
We're changing lives. I mean, every day. For example, I've been in my role as executive director for 3 years now, and we have a group of middle school young men that are going into eighth grade, 12, 13 years old. 2-3 years ago, rambunctious, didn't want to listen, just wanted to have fun. And there's nothing wrong with having fun, but part of our philosophy is that we have to meet each kid where they are. We mm-hmm. have to engage them, understand what's their dynamic, what's the family dynamic, what is causing them not to want to be a good student or to follow along with the program. So it's taken a couple of years for that to sink in, but now these young men are Wesley House ambassadors. When we had, we launched a new computer lab, those young men served as the host of that event. 2 years ago, I would not have taken my eyes off of them for a couple of minutes, okay? But now they're leaders and they're showing the younger kids how the Wesley House way is.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that always has been in place is as you matriculate through Wesley House as a kid, either after school or summer camp, you eventually had an opportunity to have a summer job at Wesley House. We actually will be employing through one of our partners, 3 former Wesley House program participants in the summer camp. So it's something that is standard, it's foundational, but it's evolving because the kids are evolving, community is evolving. So we have to stay in lockstep with what's going on in the community.
You mentioned that you guys do after school programs and summer programs. What do, in your work with the youth, what have you observed to be one of the bigger challenges that is facing St. Louis schools or St. Louis education? And then how are you guys combating some of that at Wesley House, either through your summer programs or your after school programs?
Well, one of the things educationally that has been difficult thing for me to understand is the system of individual education plans.
Mm-hmm.
What does that mean? I mean, what does it mean from the standpoint of how is it going to help that kid progress through school academically, socially? To me, at a stage when you kind of put a label on a kid, the kid takes a hold of that label and it sticks to them and they become stuck in the mindset that, hey, this is where I am. I can't make any changes. So what we do is, again, we try to meet the kid where they are, academically, physically, mentally, socially, family-wise, all of those dynamics. We try to get that information up front. And staff, volunteers, tutors, mentors, whatever the case may be, we instruct them to look for these signs or signals of trauma that may be taking place in their lives, or educational issues or family issues that are affecting them, so we can address it, understand what the impediments are to them achieving academic success, and point those out to them and work with them to do that.
Oh, so you guys make IEPs for the students too?
No, we don't. No, we don't do IEPs. We actually are kind of evolving on a daily basis.
Yeah, so.
Because what happens is when they leave Wesley House for after school or summer camp, they kind of go back to what they were doing or what they were labeled as. So it's almost like a reconditioning.
So I guess, so the IEP is the individual education plan. And mm-hmm. I think that maybe the issue isn't with IEPs and individual education plans, because what you're describing is exactly what an IEP is supposed mm-hmm. to do. But the issue is with the stigma of labeling a child either right. ADHD or
exactly.
X, Y, and Z.
Exactly.
And so I'm guessing, if I'm hearing you correctly, one of the things that you're interpreting, particularly with the students that you're dealing with, is that they kind of embrace these negative terms yes. as a part of their identity, which can sometimes be an impediment to them right. actually right. achieving true success.
Yeah. You know, I'll give you an example. I had a young man that, you know, they call me the principal. If they mm-hmm. make it to my office, they are in the principal's office, okay? So I was talking to this young man, and he said, well, you know, Mr. John, I have anger management issues.
Mm-hmm.
I've been diagnosed with that. So in a sense, he's saying that, okay, I have this anger management issue, so that gives me the right to act out, mm-hmm. to be demonstrative. But on the other end of it, trying to understand, not so much reversing that, but how to manage it. Mm-hmm. And how to manage it when you're in school, or when you're at a Wesley house, or when you're out in the community. How to manage those issues that can very well escalate to much more serious problems. Because if you look at a kid that's maybe 9, 10 years old, has anger management issues, when they become 12, 13, 14, they act out, have an incident, maybe in community, they end up in the juvenile system,
mm-hmm.
okay? Because they have basically been entitled to act with anger or frustration because they've been told, you have this diagnosis. So it's not as simple as I'm trying to state it is, but sometimes it is. Just really understanding what that kid is dealing with, whether IEP, family situation, situations in the neighborhood, whatever the case may be. We've got to be able to understand what they are faced with in order to help them understand.
So if I'm hearing you right, at the Wesley House, you guys are really building those strong relationships with the students that are coming through the doors. You're working with them on their individual needs and giving mm-hmm. them tools to really learn how to cope in society with their trauma and or their developmental diagnosis X, Y, and Z so that they can really reach their full potential before mm-hmm. they end up in a system because they were kind of misunderstood.
Right, right. And also not only the kid, but the family as well.
Mm-hmm.
For example, summer camp starts with us next Monday, but we had a mandatory parent meeting last night. We right now, we have close to 40 kids that are registered. We had close to 30 families that were represented last night.
Mm-hmm.
So from the standpoint of getting that family or that parent buy-in to what we are trying to do with them is so important. I mean, in your work and with Navigate, you probably work with the families as well to look at the placements and where the right place for them is. So the family engagement, the youth engagement, and community engagement all have to be intertwined.
So what are some of the programs that you do during the school year? And then what are some of the programs you run in summer camp? So what happens in you guys' summer camp?
Well, particularly with the school year, our focus for the last 18 months has been on closing the digital divide mm-hmm. and the technology or educational gaps that have existed prior to COVID and have been exacerbated through COVID as well, because you probably understand this, but maybe most people don't realize that when, say for before COVID started, a kid was in the first grade.
Mm-hmm.
But when they went back to school in the fall of 2021, they were in the third grade. And these were kids that may not even have been achieving at the first grade level, but now they've been moved up two grade levels without the instruction, without the comprehension, without the resources to be able to manage it. So when COVID hit, we were in a very good position to revert to some virtual programming through Zoom, mm-hmm. through YouTube, through virtual field trips, any type of way to get the kid engaged on a different level so that the tutors, the mentors could penetrate into their mindset that, okay, we're still going to allow you to be a kid through these other activities, but we got to help you keep up.
Mm-hmm.
So from that standpoint, we integrated virtual components into our mix. That included after school and summer camp. One of the biggest things that we provide for after school and summer camp kids and their families are meals.
Mm-hmm.
So when COVID hit, we were not able to have them come in the building. So we were able to distribute food to the children and their families through our food pantry operation. So we were able to continue to deliver some programming to a certain extent, keep the families fed, nourished, and so forth through the food pantry operation. And then we kept the mindset that when COVID was over, we would be able to do hybrid programming virtually and in person. And that's pretty much how things have played out. So we were fortunate to kind of, I'm not going to say be ahead of the curve, but we were fortunate to say to some funders that, okay, this is going to be an issue. How can we address it through a partnership with you? So we were able to secure additional funding, additional resources to help ease the transition mm-hmm. once COVID kind of subsided a little bit. You know, one thing I will say is that Wesley House, we are a small organization. We have 5 full-time people, 2 part-time facility folks, and 9 contract drivers that work in our Meals on Wheels program. So it's incumbent upon working with other community-based organizations to expand our scope and reach, and then also, bring in some new funders and financial resources to do what we need to do.
So is the community responding positively? How would you say, like, what gives you the hope for the work that you do? Like, how's it being received in the community?
Well, I'll go back to yesterday evening, the turnout that we had of parents at that meeting. And we explained to them that it really is a privilege for their kid to be there because we don't charge a fee for our summer camp or after school program. So the community is buying in from the standpoint of understanding that Wesley House has always been a force to be reckoned with right on the corner where we're located. Mm-hmm. And we still are making things happen in kind of a different way, but really in a very similar way. And I mean that we're doing the things Wesley House has always done, but we've incorporated new ways to deliver through technology, through drive-through food pantry distributions, through telehealth programs for senior citizens and so forth. So just the evolution of our services to keep up with the times has been very important. And that evolution has been spurned by what the community needs and what they've told us they need.
So as we're considering our partnership with mm-hmm. you guys and looking at how we move forward, how do you think about an organization like Navigate STL Schools be in position to support the kids and the families that are in the Wesley House footprint? Like, what do you think that we could be doing better? How do you think that we should be working to help these parents understand the options that are available to their families?
Well, I mean, I think the aspect of your pure existence, mm-hmm. I mean, Navigate STL Schools, I mean, that says a lot to me because when you think about maybe parents or families that are not quite as educated, they may be intimidated by the school admission or search process. So with Navigate being able to step into that gap and provide that service through a partnership with Wesley House or other partnerships that you have, mm-hmm. gives opportunities for families to understand how this all works. You know, another part of my educational story goes beyond the 12th grade, but I used to work for the United Negro College Fund here in St. Louis and Kansas City. And one of the things that was very difficult for parents and kids to navigate was the college admission mm-hmm. process. However, with the advent of more charter schools, more private schools, actually competing for our kids' attention, being able to help these families understand what the pros or the challenges may be of these different institutions. Because if you look at, well, there's Crossroads around the corner, there's the Clayton School Districts, there all of these other districts that are in private institutions that are making an impact, these families need to know that that's an option. Mm-hmm. Now, I was educated in the public school system. I'm not going to take that away. But people need to know that you have options. And they need to know that you have resources to help you navigate and get into those better situations. So I think the thing that Navigate brings to the table that has not existed is that resource for those kids and those families to understand how the back end of things work. Okay, because I mean, you look at the fact that many of the private schools, they actually recruit students and particularly athletes, and they provide transportation for them to go to school. But that's based upon their their athletic prowess, mm-hmm. first and foremost. But it's supposed to be student athlete. Okay, so I think you guys can help people understand that the academic side of it is just as important, if not more important, than the athletic side of it. And that's something that I don't know if you do or have thought about, but that's the issue that many families are dealing with, a choice of, okay, my daughter or son is a very good athlete. Mm-hmm. These schools are reaching out. They're providing transportation and so forth. But what other type of academic support are they going to provide for mm-hmm. them? Okay, what other type of support are they going to provide as far as the cultural differences and our kids coming into those cultures and being able to succeed? So, you know, I find your concept very interesting because it introduces something that is filling a gap that has existed for a long time, pretty much due to the fact of some parents not being fully educated, not understanding the education system, or for that matter, being intimidated by the process. And I see you guys stepping into that void and helping out a great deal.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. My last question for you is, how do people get involved with the Wesley House? How do they support you guys? How do they send their kids to your programs? How do we help people learn more about the resources that you provide?
Well, you know, one thing with where we're located, we basically are in, like I said, the 63115 zip code. Our footprint is Grand on the east side, Natural Bridge on the south side, Kings Highway on the west end, and then West Florissant on the north side. So within that footprint, we have enough people to work with, okay? So from the standpoint of actively recruiting, we are pulling from that population, okay? And that's what our specialty is that community. How people can get involved is through volunteerism. We always welcome tutors and mentors. Work with a couple of corporations on volunteer days, painting, refurbishing the building. There's a group of African-American women. It's called Girl Trek. Mm-hmm. And they're a walking group. It's a national organization. My wife happens to be a member, so about 8 of her Girl Trek members, they volunteer in the food pantry every month. So we're open to groups, organizations, companies coming in and volunteering. From the standpoint of funding, we are in the process of working with the Black Rep to do a fundraiser at the Black Rep, Night at the Black Rep. It'll be July the 9th. That'll be the first fundraising event that Wesley House has done in a number of years. And that is going to launch what we will call our Pillars of the Community Giving Initiative. And that will be focused towards individual donors that may have been alumni of Wesley House, may like what we're doing as an organization, and from that standpoint, really see what we're doing as a way for kids to get an opportunity through either directly through Wesley House or through one of our community partners, such as Navigate.
Perfect. All right, do you guys have socials, email, phone number you want to share?
I do, but I don't know it offhand, okay?
Oh, we'll link all it. Right, okay?
But email-wise, I'm sorry, website-wise, it's www.wesleyhousestl.org, and you can access our Facebook page through that website. Okay, so, you know, one thing I will say in closing is that I really appreciate the opportunity, okay? And I am very much encouraged to see younger African-American people do the work that needs to be done to make things happen. One of the biggest struggles that I have is finding the next me, okay? Who's going to lead that charge going into the next phase? because I'm going to sit down one day. So my point is, this is encouraging to see younger African-American people of color come into this void and see that with the help of others and make an impact. So I'm looking forward to the partnership in whatever way we can become a better partner for you. Just ask.
Thank you. And we enjoy supporting community organizations and really get into the heart of where people are so that we can truly impact their lives. So thank you for your support. Thank you for being on the show. And thank everybody else for listening.